And unless there's going to be political leadership to realize that the Europeans are in this boat together, that either they swim together or sink together, the policies might actually make the provision of liquidity more difficult. And finally, after 2013, the current IMF programs and EFSF and ECB is supposed to be phased into this European Stability Mechanism, the ESM. But this ESM liquidity provision may not occur because the politics now is going against it. And even if the ESM were to be formed, it's not obvious that countries that are in trouble today are going to regain market access. They might not regain market access, one, because technically the claims of the ESMs are more senior than the claims of the EFSF or of the EU, and therefore, if somebody in the private sector wants to lend money to these countries, are not going to do so if their claims are subordinated to official claims that are becoming a larger part of the public debt. And secondly, the ESM implies a bail-in rule that says that money is not going to be provided to countries that have unsustainable debt problem. So no private creditor is going to be willing to lend new money to countries that are in trouble if there is a situation in which their claims are going to be restructured. So unfortunately, in the case of Greece and Ireland, the sovereign spreads of this country, instead of falling, have been rising in spite of the official support, and they've reached now levels that are not going to regain essentially market access. So to conclude, I think that the experiment of the Eurozone is an important experiment, is one that actually has led to peace and stability and economic growth for most of Europe, and was an experiment worthwhile undertaking and worthwhile maintaining. But we should not put our head in the sand and not realize that there are fundamental difficulties that all these countries have to address. First of all, the countries in trouble have to help themselves, but also the core of the Eurozone, that is the ECB, the EU Commission, the IMF, and the German, have to be part of the solution. At the end of the day, in order to maintain economic, social, and political support for tough austerity and reforms, you require economic growth, because no social or political body can accept pain unless there is light at the end of the tunnel. And the light at the end of the tunnel has to be that while I'm tightening my belt today, I accept sacrifices, fiscal austerity, higher taxes, less transfers, more reforms, there has to be growth of economies, return of economic growth, return to employment growth, rather than continued contraction. So I think that the key to the sustainability of all this program is going to be the question of whether we can restore economic growth in Portugal, in Greece, in Ireland, in the rest of the Eurozone. If that happens, then the system is going to stay together. Otherwise, could be a situation that's becoming socially, politically, financially, and fiscally eventually unsustainable. I'm hopeful that the Europeans are going to think themselves as European, like they do in this country that was, as I said at the beginning of globalization, and everybody here feels that they are Portuguese, but also part of Europe. And those sacrifices here, together with the solidarity of the rest of Europe, is going to get you out of your problems. I'm hopeful that that's going to be the case, because this is a great country with a great tradition, great values, great entrepreneurship, and great opportunities, actually, to thrive in this global economy the way it did several hundred years ago. So on this hopeful note, hope that things are going to go in the right direction. And thanks very much for your interest and attention.
You may sit now and take your breath. Professor Rubini, muito obrigado pela sua intervenção. Eu deixaria agora, abriria agora a sessão às perguntas da plateia. Estamos abertos a perguntas vindas de qualquer lado e para tirar o maior proveito, eu sugeriria que começar desde já a pôr perguntas da plateia. Tenho já um candidato, por favor.
Good afternoon. I would like to ask you a question, because countries which are suffering from heavy economical and political crisis may need economical growth, which will not be achieved because there's a constant fear on investing. Which would you predict to be the best services or areas to invest on, especially here in Portugal, where there is a higher exportation than higher importation than exportation because we don't invest and we don't produce enough.
I would say that first of all, as I said, to become more competitive, to become more productive, to restore your competitiveness, you need to do the structural reform that increase productivity growth. Certainly things that lead in the direction of the reform of the state, reform of bureaucracy, reducing red tape, reducing regulations that restrict the ability to create new firms and therefore invest in the real economy, all the things that are actually required to make labor market more flexible are gonna be part of the solution. And there's a long list of things that were in the Lisbon agenda, and they're also part of what is this IMF program that country like yourself, but also Greece, Ireland, and everybody has to implement. And my view of it is this is a country that has, a lot of opportunity. You have, first of all, traditional sectors in which you have traditional comparative advantage. There is tourism, there is agricultural products, there is wine and port, but there is also an economy in which there are also new sectors that can be emerging. For example, the combination of tourism and provision of healthcare for the elderly could be one thing that's gonna be developing, not just the tourism sector, but also healthcare. Portugal could become something like a Florida of Europe, where people that come from the north come to spend time having homes, getting sound healthcare. That's something that could be viably done. It's a country where there is a good, solid, still manufacturing sector, and some of the industries like textile and others that traditionally have been labor intensive have become more capital intensive and now are competing with China and the rest of the world. So innovation, research and development, technological change can make you more efficient, more competitive, more productive. It's a country where there is a significant amount of human capital. I know personally many economists that are very fine economists who come from Portugal, but there are computer scientists, engineers, and others. Many of them are in the country. Many studied abroad and came back. I think that the human capital of the country is key. It's a country that's been always open to trade, given its own historical, history, has had previous colonies in around the world, from Africa to Latin America to Asia, has very good trading, commercial, and business relations with these former colonies, good political relationship, foreign direct investment done by Portuguese companies from Brazil to Africa to other parts of Asia could be a source of economic growth. So every country has a lot of opportunity. It has to have a policy and a regulatory framework that enhances those opportunities for investment. Invest in your people, in technology, in research and development, in innovation, in open trade, in open foreign direct investment, both inward and outward. Tech firms can come to these countries and your firms can go abroad. So there is a lot of opportunity out there.
Hello. Yeah. Professor Rubini, I was wondering if you would talk about what you think the UK's experiment in terms of trying to avoid the bond vigilantes, in terms of massive government cuts and increases in taxes, how successful do you think that will be going forward, given the sort of anemic growth you've at least seen in the first quarter of the experiment?
Well, I think that the UK case is an interesting experiment. On one sense, I would commend the Brits for what they did. They were worried that given their large deficits, the bond vigilantes would wake up, even if they had not yet done so, and therefore the government once came to power, he said we have to raise taxes and cut spending in order to avoid being in a situation like Greece or Ireland. But what has happened was that the government view was if we do a fiscal austerity and it's front-loaded, and if that implies lower economic growth, it's not the job of fiscal policy to stimulate demand and growth. That's gonna be the job of the Bank of England, by keeping interest rates lower for longer than otherwise and by doing another round of quantitative easing. That was their view 6 months ago when I met Osborne and his advisors. Now you front load it to now. First of all, even before they implemented their fiscal austerity, growth was actually negative in the fourth quarter. And even if you exclude the weather, it was flat. This quarter has been positive, but barely positive. So over the last 6 months, it's been flat. And this weak anemic growth occurred even before they implemented the fiscal austerity. And with now the rise of inflation well above the target of the Bank of England, not only the Bank of England cannot do another round of quantitative easing, but there is a chance that the next 2 or 3 months, the Bank of England is going to be forced actually to raising rates. So you're going to have fiscal austerity and fiscal drag at a time where you're going to have maybe even monetary austerity and a monetary tightening, and that could make actually the economy weaker. Now, it's an experiment that's still ongoing. We'll see the results. My view of it is that while you had to credibly commit to do the fiscal consolidation, front-loading it so much was a mistake that you had to commit today to do these things phased in gradually over the next few years by raising taxes and cutting spending gradually over time rather than front-loading it. Front-loading it has the risk that the economic downturn or the weakness is going to persist for longer than otherwise at a time where there's going to be maybe even monetary tightening. So, you know, the paradox is that the U.S. on one side is reckless on the fiscal side and the Fed has done QE2, while the Brits have decided to be disciplined in doing front-loaded fiscal austerity and be cautious and not doing QE2. The U.S. has been growing 3% recently, while in U.K. growth is close to zero over the last 6 months. We'll see whether that discipline is going to eventually get its return and whether those who have been fiscally and monetary reckless like the U.S. eventually are going to be paying for their sins. So far, that has not happened.
Please.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Professor Rubini, I would like to ask you to answer this question. How would you evaluate the possibilities of the Portuguese government avoiding to restructure its debt? And secondly, in case that's not possible, that's not avoidable, what would be the main negatives of that option?
Well, as I pointed out, you know, in no case I would say that restructuring of debt is unavoidable. Restructuring of debt can be avoided, and the key element for avoiding restructuring debt is to make the public debt and deficit deficit low enough so the debt doesn't grow, stabilizes, and then starts to fall. And also to do the kind of other reforms that restore economic growth, because as I pointed out, if output keeps on falling, then eventually you can cut spending, you can raise taxes, but if the denominator is falling, then you're not going to be able. It's going to be mission impossible. And therefore, you know, I think that implementing this program is necessary to have a chance to avoid that debt restructuring. It's necessary. If you don't implement this program, for sure the things is going to become disorderly. I pointed out, however, that there's one caveat. If a program of fiscal austerity and structural reforms is implemented even fully, but the collateral damage in the short run in terms of lack of resumption of growth fast enough, because as I said, in the short run, these things have a negative impact, and even the IMF program officially implies that growth is going to be negative this year and next year, then if it's not just this year and next year, but becomes also 2013 or 14, then it becomes economically not sustainable because output keeps on falling. And even social and political, as I said, no one's going to accept 5 years of recession, right? Eventually, people are going to say there is no light at the end of the tunnel. So the question is, will this restore growth? You can make argument both ways. And part of the answer doesn't depend only on the country, but depends on what the Germany does, depends what the ECB does, depends on whether we have a ESM and additional financial resources and how these things are implemented. So some of that is in your hands, some of it is in the hands of other authorities within the Eurozone. So I would say, is not unavoidable, but certainly a lot of hard work has to be done to avoid it. And as I said, you know, if certain things becomes unavoidable, and not predicting that for your country, then one has to think in advance about ways in which these adjustments become not a default, not like a heavy-handed restructuring, but an orderly, market-oriented reprofiling of the debt that saves times and debt servicing for the country. If and when Plan A doesn't work, if it's implemented, doesn't work, or is not implemented, and you have to think about Plan B down the line, a year or two or three from now, then if and I'm not saying that's going to be the case, if you get to that point, then one has to think about doing things that are orderly. But I do hope that actually the program is implemented, the program is successful, that therefore that option is avoided, because that option, of course, even if you try to contain the collateral damage, even if you try to contain the contagion, it has risks. Let's not think that it's riskless. It has a risk that have to be considered, that can be managed, but it's certainly risky.